and we didn't have any summer clothing. We went there in our heavy Alaskan garb, and we came into Mississippi. It was like 100 degrees in the shade, and finally they gave us lightweight clothing, and went into a barracks in Mississippi. Pearl came down with me, and she stayed with me, and she stayed in the room.
And she hadn't seen you for 27 months?
Right. I came back from the Aleutians, and we got reacquainted. And we went for a vacation to the Dells, Wisconsin. And we had a nice time. I saw all my family. That is all that was here in Chicago. And I saw my father, and other members of my family. And I had a nice 2-week vacation. I forgot what they call it.
Furlough.
2-week furlough. Yes. Yeah. And then from here, I went back to Mississippi. Pearl went with me, and while I was there, my Colonel Moore was down there, and so one day he called me in his office, because they made us replacements. In other words, they broke up our outfit, and they made us replacements. So I had a pretty good job at that time, and when they would call for 3 men to St. Louis, if you wanted to go to the camp in St. Louis near your house, I was in a position to send you there. And I was waiting that way for them to call for 3 men to Fort Sheridan or Camp Grant, Illinois, near Chicago. And I never had that call, and one day the colonel called me into his room. And he said, "Crowd," he says, "get me these 10 files." And so I was walking out, and he said, "Oh, by the way, how would you like to come with me?" I said, "I don't know. Where are you going, Colonel?" He says, "No place. We're going to stay right here in Mississippi, and I'm going to operate at a training camp. We're going to stay here." And I said, "I don't know, Colonel, I don't want to go overseas again." And he says, "Don't worry, you're not going overseas. If I find there's any threat of going overseas, I'll transfer you out." So I said, "I don't know, Colonel." He says, "Get your file too. I need some good men there." So I brought him the 11 files, and the next day we were transferred out into the 65th Infantry Division. And I went over to the new place, and I saw everybody's knocking packing crates together. And I asked, "What's going on here?" "Oh, didn't you hear? We're leaving for overseas in a short time." And I said, "Oh, no." And then the Colonel Moore fell down and broke his leg. And a bunch of us, about 10 of us or 8 of us, went over to see him. And I'll never forget, he was laying on the hospital bed with his leg stuck up in the air. And I told him I was sorry about what happened to him. And I said, "Colonel, you promised that we weren't going overseas, and that you would transfer me out if in case there was any danger." And he said, "I would, except that because of my injury, they transferred me out.
Erica,
and I can't,
excuse me.
I can't transfer you." So he got transferred out.
Give me
that. I got transferred into this new outfit, and where I didn't know anybody. And so did the fellow I worked for in the Aleutian Islands. I worked with him. His name was Carl Gaynor. And we found herself in this new outfit, knocking packing cases together and getting ready to go overseas to Europe. I didn't want to go at all. But we were there from July to December, and on the end of December, they had the Battle of the Bulge in Europe. They needed men, so they sent our outfit over to Europe and went to New York on a boat, a railroad train car, and then we went to Europe on a boat, and I was very, very unhappy about the whole thing. Got to Europe, and we got to Le Havre, that's a port in France. And got off the boat, but the boat was originally supposed to go to England, where they were prepared to get 15,000 troops. But in the middle of the ocean, because of the Battle of the Bulge, they changed our route to get off in Le Havre, France. And they weren't prepared for us. They had no facilities to get so many people there. And they took us to a place they called Camp Lucky Strike. It was a conglomeration of tents and mud and unpleasantness. And we walked around in the mud for a little while. That was in January of 1944. No.
45.
January of 1945. Yeah, because they had already done the invasion from Normandy. So we stayed there from January till March 1st. And then March 1st we got an order moving up to the front. And so the next day we got in jeeps and trucks, and they took us to a place called Saarlouden, Germany. That's in the Saar Basin, right where France and Germany meet. And they took us to a house in that city that they had taken over and left us there. The city of Saarlouden was occupied by two forces, about half by Americans and the other half by Germans. And that was my first experience with real war. They used to lob shells over in our section every night, and we used to lob shells over in their section every night. And this mansion that we were staying in was a big house with big rooms and big fancy furniture. And one night I was sitting in the dining room in a big high-backed dining room chair, and the shells were coming in very close. And one came right near the window. And one of the guys said, "When they get that close, it's time for me to go into the basement." And just when he said basement, one came right outside the window, blew out the window, and damaged everything pretty much. And the next morning I went to look at the chair I was sitting in the back of it was all pockmarked with shrapnel, because it was a high chair that where the back of it came above my head. And so I felt that was a lucky thing for me, because if I wouldn't have been sitting in a chair, I probably wouldn't be here today. And then we stayed in that Saarlouden for till March 1st. For about 4 days. And then we got an order, we're moving out tomorrow morning, and it's going to be a non-stop trip till we defeat the Germans. There'll be no taking of casualties, and we will not stop until we won the war.
Did you guys have faith that that was how it was going to play out?
I didn't know the difference. I went, I had to go. And the next morning, the attack started early in the morning, like 4 o'clock. And we got as far as a place called the Fulda, F-U-L-D-A, River. And it wasn't very far. And there we got stopped by the Germans on the other side of the river. And we kept on slugging along and going. And we were able to beat them, and we kept on going. And from then, it was nonstop. We kept on going, until we got to Austria. Every night we would take over somebody else's house.
That was all part of the Battle of the Bulge?
No, that was not part of the Battle of the Bulge. Actually, this action took place south of the Bulge. The Bulge was in Belgium. But the reason they took us there originally was because they needed troops for the Battle of the Bulge. And that was going on at the same time we were going south. We crossed the Rhine River, which is a very big river. We crossed that on a ponton bridge. That's a bridge the engineers put up to get over rivers that's on ponton things. And they have a little road on top of it to let the vehicles go by. And every night we'd stop in a different town, and we would take over the town and go into the people's houses and throw the people out. And we would take over. And the first thing the men would do when they got into somebody's house was to empty all the drawers and see what they could find.
Lots of looting.
Yeah, you were not supposed to loot, but everybody did it anyhow. And the big problem was that you could only take what you could carry. You couldn't send it back anywhere. There was no post office. So I started out, I picked up a portable typewriter that I liked very much. And then I dropped it someplace when we overtook a sweater factory. Took a bunch of sweaters. Then I dropped that for other things. And so we distributed the wealth to the country, at the same time getting stuff for ourselves. But I had my accent on the wrong thing, because I collected guns, pistols. They were heavy, and coming home I had no use for the pistols. So,
how many did you end up with?
4.
And what did you end up doing with them?
Well, Pearl wouldn't let me leave them home. So I brought them to my store on 63rd Street, and I gave them away. Except I gave 3 away, one to Harold. I don't know what he ever did with it. And I forgot who I gave the other 2 to. One I kept in the store, in my drawer in the store. I never used it, but I kept it there with a carton of bullets. And just the other day, my nephew Gary said to me, you know, there was that gun in the store, because Howard took over the store for me. And when my father died, we didn't know what to do with it. So we took it to the police station and gave it to them. And so it was sitting in the store all these years. Never got fired, I don't think. and until they gave it to the police department a very short time ago. And it, what he was telling it to me, I wished for a moment that they'd have given it back to me. I don't know what I would do with it. But
you have to register it, you have to get permits.
I did register it when I came back.
Oh, you did?
I registered all the four weapons with the City of Chicago Gun Department or whatever it was. And this one that I kept was a very cute one. It was in a case of suede, and it was very small, would fit nicely in the pocket. But I never had the nerve to put it in my pocket. That was one of the souvenirs that I brought back. But that went along through Europe. A different night in every city.
You were mostly hiking or riding?
Riding on a Jeep.
Uh-huh.
Not too much hiking.
And how long did that go on?
That went on from the day we left on end of February until May 7th. May 7th was, we met the Russians. And that was the end of the war for us. That's when Germany gave up. And we found ourselves in Linz, L-I-N-T-Z, Austria. And it was a very interesting day, one that I'll never forget. Because there was a vile concentration camp right near Linz. And that morning,
which concentration camp was
it? Mauthausen, M-A-U-T-H-A-U-S-E-N. And it was sort of an infamous concentration camp. Oh, thank you. And that morning, these thousands of concentration camp prisoners found themselves without guards. And so they were, because the guards all ran away, and they overran the town. So you can imagine a town about the size of Cleveland with all these people in green striped uniforms running around the town. And we went into the town. This other soldier and I were standing in the middle of a street at a place that was a trolley stop. They didn't have trolleys then. And a woman came running up to us, yelling in excited German that something was happening. And I finally figured out that her liquor store down the street was being overrun by these prisoners. And I went, and this other guy and I went into the store, and we told all the prisoners, get out. And we made them all leave. Then we looked in the store, and all over the store was photographs of Hitler and his sayings, Deutschland über alles, Arbeit macht frei, and so forth. And all kinds of things like that. So we went back out. The woman was standing there where we found her, and we told the people that were still outside that they could go back. Whatever happened, I don't know. The other incident that happened that night, we took over the house of the Gauleiter. A Gauleiter is like a governor. It was a very fancy house on top of a hill in Linz that overlooked the whole area. It was a beautiful house and beautiful view. And so we took over that house, and we were upstairs on the second floor we had made some K rations for us, and we heard a noise downstairs. And this other soldier and I went in the basement, and we found a half a dozen of these people with the striped uniforms that were in concentration camps. They were in the basement. And I said, "Raus, get out of here. This is for American soldiers." And this one man said to me, "Pardon me," he said, in perfect English. He said, "We've just been in the concentration camp, and it's the first time we even taste freedom. And let us stay here overnight. We won't bother anybody." So I said, "Come on upstairs." I took him upstairs. And I said, "Would you like something to eat?" And we had hot chocolate, and we had soup and some canned Spam, which is an army meat. So I offered that to him, and he ravenously ate it. And then he drank about 6 cups of hot chocolate. And he said, "You'll have to pardon me. I haven't had anything sweet to eat for a number of years. And this is so good." And so I said, "No, go ahead." He had his supper, and then he went back downstairs. We let him sleep overnight downstairs. The next morning I saw him and greeted him, and he said, "I want to thank you very much for that wonderful supper last night, but I'm sorry to tell you, I got sick. I hadn't had anything sweet to eat or anything like that for a long time, and my stomach just couldn't take it." And so, but he thanked me profusely, and then I don't know whatever happened to him. we went to this big house in the exclusive part of Linz. And we stayed there for a few days. And I remember I have a picture of a German or Austrian musical ensemble. On the following Sunday, they came to our yard and they were playing music for us. They gave us a concert in the yard. And I have a picture I took from the balcony of the house we were staying at of them in the yard playing. The other thing that I remember about that day, we came across a group of the prisoners in the green shirts. They had a man bent over a big crate, and they had a long tube that had spikes in it, not spikes, but things screwed into the sides of it. And they had this man bent over and they were hitting him. And I inquired what was happening. And they said this man was a guard in their concentration camp for a number of years. And he used to give this kind of punishment to prisoners who he didn't think did right. And now they caught him in the town and they were giving him the same kind of punishment. And I took a picture of that, and it's in my album. If you ever look, you'll see a picture of these fellas hitting the ex-guard. Then they sent us, from there, after we were there about a couple of weeks, they sent us up to a place called Kirschlag, Kirschlag, which was a small town in the mountains near Linz. And we stayed at a radio station with a big antenna, and we stayed there till August, about a couple of months. And at that time, in August, the Japs gave up, and they commenced a program of sending soldiers home. Well, if you were overseas, you got double points for being overseas. And I had been overseas so long in the Aleutians and Germany that I had the most points of anybody. So I was one of the first to go home. They sent you home according to the number of points you had. And in August, they came and said, okay, pack up, you're going back home.
So you were in it almost 4 years?
I was in from November 41 to August 45, yeah. Yeah, that's almost 4 years, isn't it?
Are these memories pretty fresh for you?
Yes. If I think back, I can see them in my mind like yesterday. It was such an unusual thing to get involved in that I remember very, very, very well. And I had, while I was in the mountains in the radio station, I had applied to be a warrant officer. That's a little less than a regular officer. And I got the paper approving the appointment. And it's in my album. You'll see it if you ever look through my album. And it says that I've been approved, but they never appointed me. And
well, that was right when you were being...
Huh?
That was right when you were being sent home.
No, that was while I was up in the mountains, probably in May or June of 45. I had to go back to division headquarters, which was about 25 miles back into Austria. Something to do with that, but I forgot what. And I couldn't get a ride. So I got a ride with a man who was on the grave detail. And he had a Jeep with a trailer on it, and he had a body in the trailer. So I went with him. I got a ride with him all the way back in the mountains. He didn't know where he was going, and neither did I. And pulling this trailer with the body. Did whatever I had to do in the division headquarters, and then I caught a ride back a couple of days later on a truck to get back to where I was supposed to be. So we stayed there through the atom bomb, August, and right after the atom bomb, they put out a rule that people with the high points could go home. And I was one of them, so I started my journey home. And that took about a couple of months, I guess. I had to go here and there and spend, you know, a couple of weeks here and a couple of weeks there. And so we finally got on a boat in Le Havre, France, and returned to the United States. It was a very happy trip for me because there was no convoy, and they could go with the lights on, and no worry that you were going to be bombed. And I was very happy to get back to the United States. Then I came back to Chicago. Found my father had married for the third time.
To whom?
He married a woman by the name of Lil. Lil. And Pearl and I, they went to live with them. They had a big apartment on Greenwood Street.
Effie had passed away?
Huh?
Effie had passed away?
No. No. He was still alive.
No, Effie.
Effie had passed away a long time before that. She had passed away when I first went into the Army. And I was in Texas and I came back for her funeral. Yeah. I don't know if I mentioned much about her, but she was a very good person.
We talked about her quite a bit.
I did.
During, right, especially in the time after the after the home.
Oh, yeah.
This was you know, a couple of months ago.
Yeah.
And have you ever gone back to Europe, to any of these places?
No.
Been back to Europe at all?
I often thought that I would like to go back to Sarlaten, where I stayed. I stayed for all that time under attack when it was pretty dangerous. And one incident that happened as we were on our march to Linz, we stopped for the night and took over a house, and everybody decided to clean their rifles. And I was sitting at the end of the bed in the second floor bedroom of this house. No, I was sitting on the side of the bed, and there was another guy cleaning his rifle at the end of the bed. And all of a sudden, there was a shot, and it was right. The rifle went off maybe 2 inches from my head, and I thought, "Oh my gosh, I've been hit. I'm going to die." And I wonder what Pearl will say when she gets the telegram. I thought all that through it in a second time. And then finally somebody said, "Get up, Kraut, you're not hurt." And I felt my head, and it wasn't. And I got up, and that was a harrowing experience.
The bullet missed you, in other words.
It missed me by about, we looked in the wall. Some guy measured in the wall where my head was. He said I missed by about 2 inches. There was a hole in the wall.
So when you came back...
So I came back, and then I... the question was what to do with my life.
Now, during this time before you got back, was Auntie Pearl working, or...?
She worked at, She worked for the U.S. Treasury, I think. When we were in Mississippi, she worked for a Ford agency. But then, up here, I think she worked they had war bonds. Did you ever hear of those?
Mm-hmm.
And she had something to do as she was typing up war bonds or something like that. And she was working there. It was the Merchandise Mart in Chicago. And but when I came back, she didn't work anymore.
Mm-hmm. So you came back and started tailoring again?
Yeah. I had
worked for your father?
Yeah, I had left a job at J.B. Simpson as an assistant designer. And when I came back, I went to see them. And they offered me, they said, "We've been holding your job for you. We want you to come back." And they offered me an increase of $3 a week. And my father, pretty strong-willed character, he was always thinking that I should come into business with him. So I decided to go with him. And he changed the name of the company to J. Kraut and Son. And I started working there. And at that time, they had a system of priorities. If you had to get certain things, you had to have a priority. And I read up on it, and because he couldn't get wounds to make suits without a priority. And if you could get that, you could sell suits and do well. So I applied for 1,000 yards of goods under a priority, and it came through.
What was the basis of the priority?
If you're a veteran, and if you can, and if you had a need. And there was a few other things, but I figured it couldn't hurt, and I applied for it. And then when I got that, I went to the woolen companies, and I said, I want to buy some woolens. And they said, where's your priority? I said, here it is. And so I had, we had 1,000 yards. That'd be enough to make about 300, a little less than 300 suits. So my dad was very happy with that because now he had woolens. And everybody started learning that we had some woolens and I could make them suits. And the business was very good. We started doing very good. My father went to Florida that winter with Uncle Oscar for a vacation. And then the next year he went with Uncle Oscar too. And then the following year he had an operation from which he did not survive. Reminded me when Aunt Natalie died, it reminded me of he had the same kind of death.
Do you know what kind of ailment he had?
You want to know something? I never knew. I just remember when I asked, what's wrong? He told me he had a mass in his stomach.
Hmm.
And he went to Woodlawn Hospital, and they brought in a surgeon from the University of Chicago who was a very, very nice man, but he was very upset that things didn't work out. And so then when he died, I took over the store, continued to work there, and he had an estate. The store was actually owned by Harriet and Natalie and me. And so I purchased their interests and started running it myself and did pretty good.
Did you keep the same name or change it?
I kept the same. No, he called it J. Kraut & Son, and I called it Kraut Taylors.
Where was that? Oh, where was that?
It was on 63rd Street, 1135 East 63rd Street. And so it was in 45, in about 49, I remodeled the interior. There was a big fur vault in the store that was about 8 feet by 10 feet square, maybe bigger. Big room with two huge safe doors on it. And I felt I needed the space more for retailing than I did for storing fur coats, which I used to do. And so I had that torn down, and I had that extra square feet for retail space in the store. And I put new shelves in, and made new lighting, new door, made it very nice. And business kept up very well, kept up pretty good. And until a few years after that, I wanted a bigger store yet. So that store had a deep vestibule, about 20 feet, I guess, with two big display windows, one on either side. And I decided to make the store bigger. I could use that front space. So I tore all that out, and I put in a different front. Instead of having two big windows, I just had one window. And I used all the other space for retail space. Worked out very good. And kept on with that business, which went along very nice. Was able to support the family very good. And then somewhere along the line there, I decided that I should see how far I could go in college.
Did you have even a high school diploma?
Yes, that's all I had. Mm-hmm.
But you never went to college at all because of all the because of the war and everything else.
For two reasons. First, I wouldn't say because of the war.
No.
My father was not college minded. He used to say, "You want money? Work." And he was very happy that I went to work. And I decided, first I took correspondence courses by mail. And then I took a course from the University of Chicago where they gave a set of Encyclopedia Britannica to the student who does best in it. And I was the one who got it.
You know what the class was?
Political education, some political class.
Political science or something like
political
that?
Political science. And I still have the letter, which is in my box, that says, "Congratulations, you won the Encyclopedia Britannica." It was about 30 books. And I thought if I had the ability to do that, maybe I'll try some correspondence courses besides. So I took a few and I got college credits for each one.
You were doing all this while you were working your store full time?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then the credits were coming very slow because you only got 3 hours for each course. So if I could take two courses in one semester, I get 6 hours, 12 hours a year. And it was going slow, so I decided to go two nights a week to evening school. And I went to Roosevelt University. I had a guy working for me by the name of Casey. Remember him?
Sure I do.
And he was very good. And I used to leave him in the store at night when I, the nights that I was, I went Tuesday and Thursday, but we were open nights on Thursday. And he would take care of things during that period. And I would go have supper and go to school. And that way I took enough courses, history, writing, all kinds of courses like that, until I, over a period of about 6 years or 7 years, until I got enough credits to get into law school.
So, in other words, it took you about 7 or 8 years to graduate college?
Yeah, about 6 years, I guess.
6 or 7 years, okay.
We're almost done with this particular tape, but the one question I wanted to ask you is, in the same time when you had your tailor shop, Aaron Trock was also a tailor in that same area?
Yes, he was pretty far away. He was on 73rd at Bennett, and I was on 63rd in the university.
I see.
So he was a little way away, and he didn't do much making clothes.
Mm-hmm.
He did mostly cleaning and repairs, and he had a reputation for being an excellent tailor. But he was there, and I used to see him all the time. We used to discuss tailoring business. Any other questions till now?
No, let me stop this because this tape is about done.
You were starting to tell a story about the twin bed. Go ahead.
When Charles came back from the war, his father let us stay at their apartment. He had married for the third time, and she wasn't exactly a very bright woman. Well, we first night we stayed together, we had twin beds. Second night, she had the one bed taken out to give her son a sleeping room, and said that we could sleep with just the one twin bed. There was no way that we could sleep in one twin bed. So we went to his father, and Daddy made her bring the bed back in the room, and we had double twin beds. But it was a very bad experience to think that they didn't think of us after we was away for so many years to have a little bit more comfort.
Yeah, well, maybe they thought it would be nice to be in a twin bed, nice and close.
Lil said, you don't need any more room, you're lovers. One bed is big enough for both of you.
So, but it wasn't true.
So in her mind, it should have been satisfactory.
She pulled another one.
Oh. Maybe she thought you were sleeping single file.
Natalie had a beautiful tablecloth, and she had us for dinner one night, and Lil smoked. She takes her cigarette and puts it on the tablecloth and made a big hole in it. She said, oh, that was for good luck. And Natalie was furious.
Yeah.
How come none of you kids smoked? None of you smoked at all, Charles?
No.
Oh, my mom, you smoked, a little bit when I was a kid. I saw you smoke. I told you not to smoke.
There was one time, this is a cute story. Charles had a very rich uncle.